Dun, da, 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 da,
Returned.
da, 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 da. That's not Disney. I can't say that.
That intro works too.
That was Superman.
Yeah, I mean, but it's thematically fitting.
The Incredibles 1 and Incredibles 2. The Incredibles 2 wasn't good enough to have a the in front of it, so it must be shamed.
Wait, is there not a the?
No, it's just Incredibles 2.
I never noticed that.
I'm disappointed that they didn't call it the second Incredibles or the second Incredible, because that was the name of my fan fiction, and because the movie doesn't represent my fan fiction, I hate it.
But I wanted it to be like that, like Dumb and Dumberer, and just be like the Incredibler.
Incredibilist.
Yeah, the third one would be the Incrediblest, because any movie that's title is an adjective, the sequel just has to be like the superlative form.
So, Incredibles and Incredibles 2. By the way, both of these films will be spoiled in this review. It's kind of unavoidable, especially with Incredibles 2.
Right. I mean, at this point, if you're worried about getting spoiled for Incredibles 1, I just have no words for you. And like Incredibles 2, I would get like that's still relatively new. So like, if you don't want to hear the spoilers, then you don't you maybe don't watch. But yeah, so there's gonna be some, several, like pretty much all of them.
Yeah, exactly. So let's start with the first one. It was made by, what's his name? Oh yeah, Brad Bird, the guy who made the
Brad
Iron
Bird.
Giant and later Ratatouille. He also worked
Brad
on The
Bird is.
Simpsons too, on such episodes like Marge versus the Monorail. What, you know, those
I have
classics.
no mental context for that
You
myself.
will someday.
But Brad Bird is a cool guy. He's a homie.
Yeah, he seems like a
He also
great guy
voiced
too,
Edna.
like in interviews
He
and
voices
stuff.
Edna. Yeah.
Yeah, and he voices
He's
Edna.
the. Yeah.
So he'd always been a fan of superhero stuff, so we decided, hey, let's make one for Pixar. This was a big step for Pixar, because sure, there were humans in Toy Story and Monsters, Inc., none in Bugs Life, but this was the first Pixar movie to ever fully star a human cast. No talking animals, none of that.
Right. I mean, there was a robot, but the robot didn't talk.
Yeah, and it was hardly the star.
Yeah.
But, and let me say, this film still looks great. I mean, yeah, it's a little
Oh,
primitive,
yeah.
but it still looks great.
Right, yeah, like, when I look at it, like, I don't think, oh, the animation's so old. Like, I can look at Toy Story. Like, mind you, I absolutely love both of the original Toy Stories and the third one too. But like you look at the first two ones and you obviously think this animation's really old. Like The Incredibles, I don't even like that doesn't cross my mind. I never once when watching it think like, oh yeah, this is so old. Like it was good back then. Nah, it's just
I mean,
great.
Finding Nemo was like definitely one of the big jumping points for having their animated films look this good. But
Yeah.
they really honed it here, because going from how plastic Andy and his family looked in the first Toy Story to now this is a massive step in technology.
Absolutely. Like, yeah.
But the
Just
film is more than
you
just
look.
its looks. It's also about its story, which is, in a world full of superheroes, Mr. Incredible seems to be the talk of the town. That is, until he goofs up by saving someone who didn't want to be saved. Oh no! So then people start suing superheroes, and then they have to go undercover, hiding, no longer allowed to save anyone again. So Mr. Incredible gets married to this superhero, Elastigirl, and, well, they have a fun life together, except he really misses the glory days. So then a mysterious woman named Mirage invites him to come do some superhero missions behind the government's back, and one thing leads to another. He meets Syndrome, his now new arch nemesis, and must save the world while his family joins into the third act.
And meanwhile, the whole time, Bob, aka Mr. Incredible, his suspicious secret superhero action, it comes across as very suspicious and leads to this, like, low-key affair undertone subplot.
Yeah. With the help of Edna Mode.
and guest.
One of the best characters, darling. That was terrible, I apologize. But Edna, yeah, voiced by Brad Bird, the costume designer. So there's a lot of great things about this, but, like, it's kind of hard to bring something new to the table. But, so right. We'll just go over some of, like, the basic stuff. The story is a lot of fun.
Yeah, like, it's... like, it's hard to make a, like, new, unique superhero movie. Because, like, even, like, not to say you can't have good ones, like... I love Infinity War, and I love most of, like, the Marvel movies that come out today, but, like...
I do not.
That being... well, that being said, I can't quite say any of them are, like, oh, they're, like, new and different.
Don't get me started.
Regardless, The Incredibles, however, is one that you definitely can look at and be, like, this is, like, something that's... well, first of all, it's animated and, like... but it's not just, like, some cartoon, like, Superman cheesy thing. It's actually, like, I'd, like, put it on the same level as, like, other superhero movies, despite it being, like, all animated and all. But, like, still, it's just, it's very fresh. That's the thing I say. And a big reason for that is it's, even though I literally just said how, like, I... hold it in high regards as a superhero movie, but one of the best things about it is it's not really just a superhero movie. If anything, it's more about, like, the family dynamic, just in a superhero setting.
I completely agree. I mean, yes, the superhero stuff is nice, but the characters are so well fleshed out that mm-hmm. you can't help but care about their plights and their issues, and you kind of bond to them really quickly.
Yeah. What? Like, because they... even, like, they're very relatable, like, just the family dynamic in of itself is just a relatable dynamic, and so you just get to see these, like, relatable, down-to-earth, very real people going through very real people problems.
Despite the, like, fact that they're superheroes.
Right, yeah.
But my favorite character in this whole thing is actually what I think that this film gets better than any other Pixar film ever, the villain. Syndrome is the best yes. Pixar villain, hands down. Better than Stinky Pete, better than Sid, better than Randall, Mr. Waternoose, and especially better than, what is it, the pterodactyls from Good Dinosaur, who were in, like, two scenes? I don't know.
Whatever. Whatever. It's like, yeah, Syndrome, I would go as far to say he's up there as one of my favorite just movie villains, period.
Absolutely.
He's so well written. Like, he's a very, very delicately balanced between being super goofy and comedic and a total dork, and also being legitimately threatening and, like, a serious threat as a villain.
Syndrome
is not an easy thing to do.
Syndrome starts off as Mr. Incredible's biggest fan, and then he gets rejected, so all these years later he becomes vengeful and angry, so he decides to take it out on superheroes, one by one killing them off until there's no more superheroes, until he is able to come up and defeat a fake villain of his own. Then he'll become mm-hmm. the new superhero, and once he has his fun, he'll sell off all his gadgets to everyone, so everyone can be super. And when everyone's super,
no one will be.
That's one of the best quotes, because that is actually a pretty good point. Syndrome right, is, like, yeah, he's a bad guy, but you can definitely see where he's coming from. He wanted to be super mm-hmm. all his life, he kept getting shot down, so why not kind of rise up against that and help all those other people? Because, yes, he does right. want to actually help people and save them, albeit for ulterior motives, but he's mm-hmm. just got bad methods of doing it.
Yeah, exactly. Like, if you just break it down to, like, just, like, the thought process and, like, motivations, Syndrome, like, in almost any other movie, would be the hero if you just, like, were looking at the thought process that goes behind it. Like, he's... like, in so many movies, we're trained to root for the underdog, and, like, you don't have to, like, you can be special on your own. Like, everyone can be special if they just, like, utilize their own unique talents. You're not just, like, born into specialness, and, like, it's not just, like, the select few. Like, in almost any other story, Syndrome would be the hero, but it shows us just a really different side of it that, like, sometimes people, like, who might have the same ideas in just a different circumstance, in different scenarios, different lots of things, but just... You've seen, like, yeah, you know what I'm getting at.
Absolutely. I mean, we've all seen it. We all know what works. Now, let's get on to Incredibles 2.
Which, when I learned it was going to be a thing, I was super stoked.
Mm-hmm.
And
as with everybody.
Yep, it was... The Incredibles, there are some movies where I'm like, that movie doesn't need a sequel. Like, that'd be a waste of time. Don't even bother.
Monsters, Inc.
Yes. The Incredibles was not one of those movies. It holds its own perfectly fine and didn't need a sequel. Like, it didn't leave you like, oh, I need to find out we need to find out the rest of it and all. Like, it's not like that, but, like, I always felt like, yeah, there can be a sequel. This can keep going. And it did! And how did they do? Far from bad, I'll say that to start off. Far from bad.
I mean, when I first saw it, you and I were like... I mean, we were both kind of caught up in the excitement, so it's like...
Mm-hmm.
But I think that wore off for me really quickly, because I don't know when it wore off for you, but it wore off for me at the third act, because then I'm like, wait a minute, this movie is not that good.
Right, yeah, it's... Like I said, it's I would say it's far from bad... And it is a honestly pretty strong sequel.
Like, it's just not better... what we were looking for.
Right, it's not perfect by any means, and overall quite flawed. And yeah, it has a lot of strong elements and does pretty good overall, but it's just not quite great.
Yeah, there's, like, a lot of good things and a lot of bad. So for me, it, like, kind of boils down to, like, a 5.5 out of 10. But don't just take numbers for it. Let's actually get into the meat of what is good and what is bad about it. Let's start with the good, because there are some good things, and I have a feeling that this is going to get increasingly more negative. First of all, the animation, fantastic. Again, They really upped their game. Pixar, despite the fact that their movies have kind of been pretty bad lately, save for Inside Out. You know the type, the Finding Dory, which is just all right. Good Dinosaur looked amazing, was a pretty bad movie. You know the type. So,
yeah.
But so of course they're going to bring their 5-star animation to a movie that was just anticipated for years, like over a decade actually.
Mm-hmm.
The action scenes are well choreographed. Everything looks great. I like Violet's subplot in this, how she actually wants to kind of have a normal life. It was touched on in the first one, but she's given a lot more screen time here, and it's kind of fleshed out.
Yeah, I do. I like that, too. That was one of the highlights for me as well.
Mm-hmm. The first 20 minutes, I'd say, like the first act, them getting kicked out of their house. No, the house blew up. Never mind. So, like, whole bit, that was fantastic. I loved it. When they get to the super billionaire guy, I think that's when it starts to take a little bit of a dive.
Right. I wouldn't quite say dive, just...
Like, that's when it starts. That's when the slowdown starts.
Yeah.
Yeah. But, like, that first little bit, the first act, I'd say, very well done. It felt just...
It started off really strong, I would agree, yeah.
And I think that might be one of the things that makes everyone kind of look at it funny, is because it started off so strong.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, also...
And as it went on, yeah, it... I would again say it never got to a point where I thought, like, oh, this is bad, it, like, ruined what it started out with, but it just was like, didn't quite live up to what it could have been.
There was one of those moments for me, and we'll get to that. One other thing I gotta say is it's great to hear the cast again, with save for one who died. I don't remember his name, but he's the guy who played,
Bud Lucky.
Yeah, him. So, yeah, he's dead. Everyone else is back. Well, except Syndrome, but we know what happened to
Dash
him.
Dash has a different voice actor, because...
All right, fair point.
His old voice actor is grown up.
Yeah, fair point on that.
And I assume Jack-Jack does, too. Because, like, it's like they don't just get baby sounds of, like, some sound effect site. They actually got to get a baby to record it.
Yeah.
And they got a different baby, but, like, that doesn't really affect much.
And I know that this film isn't, like, being received the best, but there is one really good thing that I'm surprised nobody talks about. For being a sequel, especially a Pixar sequel, which, save for, like, the Toy Story ones, never seem to pan out well. They always seem to rehash, like, take a look at Finding Dory. Mm-hmm. This one is not a rehash. It's its own new story and continuation.
Right. There's... it doesn't rehash really anything.
No.
Like, it just... It utilizes elements of the first, carries them over, brings new things to them, and just develops them further, and it does that very well.
It does.
All the things that it carries over, just continuing from the first, are done really, really well.
That's where I'd say the good stuff ends. Let's get to the negatives. First off, a very nitpicky one. What was up with that seizure scene? Like, that thing that caused epilepsy?
Right.
I mean, in this very safe culture, you can't honestly tell me that nobody thought of that. Right?
I mean, I think they probably did, and that's why there are a lot of warnings for it. Like,
but why put it in the film at all, then? Right?
Yeah. I mean, it... For me, I don't have epilepsy or anything, so, like, didn't directly affect it for me. And, like, I didn't have a personal issue with it, but it was just kind of struck me as a little odd, because it's just, like, I can kind of just limit your audience a bit.
It did give me a headache, actually. I mean, I don't have that either, but it kind of hurt.
I get that. I didn't get a headache myself. But, like, I can... Yeah, it's a little bit of a strange choice. Like, maybe you could have just done, like, a swirly screen or something. You don't need to, like, flash it all over, I guess, but yeah, that's more for me. I feel like just like a kind of odd choice on their part that didn't really too badly negatively affect anything for me, but it's just kind of like odd, like, why would you do that?
Yeah, and one other thing that some people are starting to bring up now that the hype is kind of down, the characterization is fine in this movie except for Mr. Incredible. He is way off. Something about him just did not feel right. I mean, yes, I understand what they're going for. He wants to go back into the spotlight thing, because that was his whole thing in the end. But he is kind of back. He's had his fill. That's kind of the point of the first movie. And even then, I'm sure that the Mr. Incredible in the first movie would have supported Elastigirl's new foray in there. I mean, yeah, the fatherhood thing would be hard, but that doesn't mean he'd try to, like, kind of shut her out and get all jealous and indignant over it.
Yeah, I did think a lot of, like, the kind of, like, parenting thing, and he kind of, like, got, like, more and more, like, disheveled as he, like, the parenting went on. That I thought that was kind of funny.
Oh, yeah,
like,
definitely.
That aspect of it. But, like, yeah, the kind of, like, extreme jealousy side of it was just kind of like, I'm not sure about that, guys.
Yeah. That didn't feel right. Also, a lot of people complain about, like, the feminism thing. I don't care about that. It wasn't intrusive. It actually felt right for the story. I've only got a problem with, like, that when it, like, impedes on the story. Like, when you stop it just to have some forced message. Kind of like the Emoji Movie. That was one of its many, many problems.
Yeah. I was hearing stuff from people, like, before we saw it. There was just like, oh, it's so, like, political heavy. Got this big feminism thing, it completely ruined it. And I watched it, and I'm like, a couple times I noticed, like, yeah, I can see some big feminism vibes coming through, but again, like, it never was distracting or overbearing, even when it was there, which I honestly felt like was a lot less than I was expecting.
And, you know, it takes place in, like, the 60s. That's when this kind of stuff was happening. I mean, specifically at the 60s part that they're at, that's when, I mean, civil rights was starting to happen, and a lot of people point to that as just race, but it was more than that. It was also gender equality, and you guys can debate in the comments whether or not we're actually there right now, but that's not what we're here to discuss, so I guess it kind of makes sense in the time frame, too. Also,
I didn't mind that too much, that aspect. It very very much little bothered me. That was a poorly worded sentence.
There's one more thing that I'm gonna bring up as a negative. Now, this is a huge negative in my mind. This is kind of what killed the movie a little bit, and it's gonna seem small, but it leads to a point, and it's gonna lead to some bigger things in the end. The villain is awful.
Yeah, that's... Yeah.
And it's not just in comparison to Syndrome. Every villain's gonna suck in compared to Syndrome for Incredibles. You can't get better than him.
Right.
But... Screenslaver? First off, that name kind of sounds like a World of Warcraft username, not a villain name. Mm-hmm. And it's so obvious who the villain is. They try to throw in the red herring and then go like, oh, it actually was the red herring the whole time, but it's not clever. Everyone already knew it was going to be her. Her name is Evil Endeavor.
Yeah. It was... And being predictable and like... Knowing who the villain is isn't always bad. There's a lot of times where, throughout an entire movie, the audience might be fully aware of who the villain is and the characters don't. There can be some good use of dramatic irony there.
Mm-hmm.
But in this case, when you're trying to keep it a secret and you're not, it's just...
Because, like, it's so proud of how it tricks you. And it's like, no, you didn't trick me. I knew this the whole time.
Right.
And even, and like, that's it, not... like, it tries to play with the audience and toy around, and it's like, oh, you can't guess it. You can't guess it. We're like, yes, we can. Her name is Evil Endeavor. Change the name and make her not act so obviously villain.
I was really hoping that it would just be like, that she would just be a red herring, and if she was and someone else was the villain, like, I would have been like, all right. Thanks.
This kind of stuff is why I'm getting really annoyed with Disney villains as of late, because they're all that twist surprise villain, and it's so been done, and it's so boring now. It's not interesting.
Yeah, like, twist villains can be done really well. Like, Syndrome is a twist villain.
Yeah, but he comes in halfway through, he's established, and his motivation actually makes sense. The logic that...
Right.
Evil Endeavor follows makes no sense. You want to get rid of the superheroes because your dad died and they couldn't come to save them because they were underground? And what?
Yeah, it's just like, don't blame that on superheroes or the government. Blame that on your dad just being stupid.
Yeah.
Because, like, he knew they were illegal, didn't he?
And it's funny, because a lot of people...
What did he expect to happen?
I've argued this with a lot of people. They said, no, she's interesting because she's got an interesting backstory. Backstories don't make a character. Like, take a look at, like, Frollo. Yeah. He's got, like, no backstory. Fascinating character. And then take a look at Evil Endeavor here. Backstory? Nothing. So it's kind of the inverse of what happened with Syndrome. Syndrome kind of had a basic backstory. He was the fan who wanted to be a part of the action, didn't get to, so he's now the villain. Simple backstory, phenomenal character. Evil Endeavor has this, or Screenslaver, whatever, has this really complex and overly complicated backstory, and she's boring.
It's the parents dying. It's like, it almost just feels like something out of a fan fiction. Like, my parents died, and now I must get revenge on them.
Yeah, it's just so boring.
Yeah.
But the thing is, it wouldn't bother me so much if it didn't think that it was so exciting. You know, I'm actually going to kind of use the prequels here as an example. Yes, the prequels did something better than Incredibles 2. Palpatine. Everyone knows that Palpatine is going to be the Emperor. Everyone knows. He's played by Ian McDiarmid. He's just got the...
wasn't supposed to be a secret. It's the same, like, dramatic irony
thing. No, I'm saying, like, it's obvious. But the thing is, like, here's the thing. Same thing with Evil Endeavor. We know that they're the villain. But the thing is, Palpatine is still fun and still interesting. Just because you have a complex backstory and, oh, you're quote-unquote surprised, that doesn't change anything. Your villain is still weak. And because the villain is weak, the whole third act, when she's revealed, just kind of takes a dive. It's not interesting. I don't care about this. I couldn't care less about her motivation or what she tries to do for anything, because she's just boring. I don't even get what her plan is. Because it's so needlessly complex.
Superheroes look bad, so they'll be illegal again.
Yeah, I didn't.
And also, just no. Like, I just, like. This is a bit of a nitpick, but, like, like, because all the superheroes are mind-controlled when they're, like, wearing the glasses. Is nobody who's, like, watching this or, like, seeing this think it's suspicious that, like, all the superheroes who are being evil all of a sudden are all wearing the same glasses with glowy eyes?
Yeah, no, that's something.
No one just, like, thinks, like, huh, I wonder why they're all acting evil and wearing these evil-looking glasses.
And I also can't really take her that much of a comic book villain either, like a superhero villain, because she's never in costume. I know that's kind of a nitpick thing, but like Syndrome fully embraced it, because he's kind of a stereotypical both comic book dweeb and comic book villain. Evil Endeavor never gets into the costume. That's just a fake who does it. So she feels more like
I think that was kind of intentional, because like the screen slaver identity was just some...
But I'm saying, like, it doesn't fit. It doesn't fit.
Yeah.
I mean, maybe they're trying to go for a Lex Luthor thing, but again, it also doesn't fit there, because they're trying to have their cake and eat it too, which I don't need... You get what I'm saying there.
Right, yeah.
And also, this is another nitpick, but why doesn't she die? Like, are we so PC now that we can't have them die? I don't know. It's just like, I know Syndrome's death was an accident. They probably would have brought him to jail had they had the chance. But... I don't know, maybe it would have been a little more impactful, something, because her getting hauled off just felt really anticlimactic.
The whole climax just kind of felt anticlimactic, to be honest.
I mean, it had some great build-up with the ship and everything, but then it just kind of stopped. Right.
Yeah, it's just kind of like, there we go, we win. The end.
Yeah. And it just, but the ending was kind of funny with them driving Violet on the date. That was kind of funny.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
This is another, actually, thing I brought up. I don't know if this is a good thing or a bad thing, but this is the first Pixar movie to have cursing in it. Nothing extreme, but it's there.
I wasn't sure how to feel about that. On one hand, I was like, I can kind of appreciate that it's being kind of mature with some of its dialogue and all, but at the same time, it's like, why do you really need to do that? Like, it just kind of seems a little out of place, and just, like, kind of, I feel like, again, kind of was just, like, almost trying too hard to be mature. So, like, I appreciated the effort, but, like, is it really, like, you'd need to...
Yeah. When we saw it in the theater, remember, like, there was some families in there when the first, H dropped, they were like, because they brought some kids with them, and we're like, oh, no, and I even remember when we were done, like, I'm not showing that to my kids. No way.
Right. Like, wait till they're, like 12 or something.
Yeah, because there's also, like, a lot of drunkenness there. There's a scene where Elastigirl and Evil Endeavor get drunk. Remember that scene? There's just a lot of, like, uncomfortable things in there that's not really meant for kids. The short notwithstanding, I actually really like that short.
Yeah, I did. Yeah, too.
Yeah, wow. So, final thoughts on Incredibles 1 and 2.
1 is fantastic. One of, if not... It's definitely in the running for best Pixar movie. I struggle with saying the best just because there are so many that I love so much, but it's definitely one of.
Agreed. Just
all around so well. Such a well-made movie. So good.
Agreed.
The second one... Good? It's like... It did its job. Aside from Toy Story 2 and 3, I'd say it's probably my favorite Pixar sequel.
Well, then what else do you have? There's Monsters U?
Exactly. There's... Well, technically, Monsters U isn't a sequel.
But I count it. That and Finding Dory. Yeah. So, that's third place out of 5. That's not the best.
Right. And then the car... Yeah, the car stuff, which...
Oh, yeah.
It's like... A couple, like, I consider Monsters U and Finding Dory just very mediocre, and the Cars, I haven't actually seen Cars 3.
Cars 3 is pretty good.
We all know how Cars 2 went.
Yeah, Cars 2 is definitely the worst Pixar movie, but I don't know, I thought Cars 3 was good. Not as good as Incredibles 2, but yeah, aside from, like, Toy Story, they can't really do sequels very well, I guess. Which I guess is why they're going to Toy Story 4, which we all want to see that. It's not like the story ended perfectly or anything.
Yeah. So, like, The Incredibles 2, like I said, it's not bad. It's far from bad, but it makes a lot of mistakes.
It does.
It's like, the kid that, so like, it's like the two kids in your class, one of them just gets a perfect A. Like, of course, you expected that. Like, they wouldn't get anything less than a perfect A, or, like, great job, knew you could count on you. The other kid gets maybe like a B, maybe like a B minus maybe, and you're like, you did good, and they're just like you showed your work, you did like the right things, but that was supposed to be a positive, but you made it a negative, and that threw off the whole equation. And that lowered your grade. Sorry.
I'd kind of give it like a B minus or C plus, something
right.
there.
I'd probably say B minus is where I'm putting it, but I give it a pat on the back and said, good try. And again, not bad at all, but just not quite really good.
It just wasn't what a lot of the fans wanted, and it just had some real extensive flaws in there.
Yeah.
I mean, it could have been way worse.
There's one thing that we didn't really cover, which was the humor, which in most aspects did pretty darn well.
Yeah, and I think that is one of the redeeming qualities. But can we really fault it for not being the movie we all expected? No, I mean, that's kind of up to us. Can we fault it for being objectively flawed and having a lot of issues? Yes.
Yeah.
And really, though, they could have done a lot worse. Like, they could have just gone, like, maybe Elastigirl's biggest fan goes nuts, and then they want to do all this stuff, and then they do, like, the Elastigirl goes out, well, Bob takes care of the kids. That would have been terrible.
Yeah.
So, at least they tried to make it original, and they did. It wasn't a rehash. But what they churned out wasn't the best. Not the worst, but not great.
Yeah.
It was far from incredible.
It was incredibly decent.
Incredibly above average.
Yeah.
All right, guys. Like, what did you think of Incredibles 1 and 2? Tomorrow is the last one to the film that never really got to exist, actually. But the form it does exist in is terrible. We're finishing it off with talking about two movies again, and this time, oh boy. One of them's gonna hurt.
Two movies that are kind of the same movie, but also very much not the same.
One of them's good, the other is atrocious. What's it gonna be? Tune in tomorrow, unless you're clever enough to go back to our announcement video and then find out what it is. But you won't do that!